if I say what sounds trite and hackneyed, that it's a pleasure to be here, it's not. It's not coming from the necessity to say that. It's not only a pleasure to be here, it's an honor. And I thank you so much for the invitation. I really feel blessed to have the experience of meeting the wonderful staff first, and then your wonderful kids, who really were wonderful, and so inquisitive, asking very bright questions. And I promise, when you get to know me, you'll know that I would not say that gratuitously. I would not say that for any other reason than that was really my experience. It's really been a pleasure. What do you want from your kids? Many of whom, some of whom are here tonight. Here, let me rephrase it. What would make you feel good if you could picture into the future your children? That's a real question. Yes, please.
Responsible.
I like that. That's in fact the right answer. Right away. Did you cheat on them? You haven't written on your sleeve. But that's a very good answer.
Responsible.
Compassionate. Good. You probably won't be wrong in this, so fire away.
Resiliency.
Ah, resiliency. That's very important and big word these days. I'm sorry? Happy. Yes, but remember, they could be happy being an axe murderer or a bank robber. So, are you happy? Yes, I am. It's very nice here behind bars. But I think I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Hardworking, of course. Self-confident. That's what you had, Martha, also. Okay, one more.
Empathetic.
Okay, well, compassionate, very similar things. Well, then, go out and make them that way. That's what you want. But how? That's the question. We all know that. But how? So let's start with one of those things, and actually let's start with the first thing that we heard. And I'll set it into a context. I'm a clinician. Which means that people, whether they should or not, whether they're glad they did or not, come to me with problems. They never come to me when everything's going fine, not at the prices I charge. They come to me with problems. If they say everything's fine, I'll say, well, that's good, but why are you here? And then the answer to that, why are you here, is always kind of similar. There's always some kind of repetitive quality to what brings people to a psychologist. A woman would say, it's men, doc. I'd say, well, what do you mean? Well, she said, I'm good looking, and she was very good looking, this one woman, very classically beautiful, I would say, in her early 30s. She says, it's not that I have a problem getting boyfriends. I've had many boyfriends, and I like men, and I've actually been engaged. But here's the thing, I've been engaged twice. And both times, as the marriage got closer, as the wedding date got closer, I started acting weirdly, and I broke off the engagement. And now I have a boyfriend who loves me, and I love him, and I want to get married, and I want to start a family, and I'm worried about why this always happens to me. So that's why I came. And I thought, okay, well, that's pretty clear. A fellow comes in and says, I have a job, I'm an engineer, I have a good job, but I have a big mouth. And my problem is, I can't keep it closed. So I'm always telling the boss how to do things better. I'm always pushing people around. And I generally disingratiate myself to all my coworkers. And before long, I'm either fired or I quit. And I don't want to do this anymore. Why does this always happen to me? Or I went home for the holidays. And I get along very well with my family at first. But before long, we're at each other's throats. We can't wait to get out of there. Why? Does this always happen to me? What a good question. Let's say this weren't kind of stand for the electronics, and this weren't a gym, but let's say instead it were a kitchen and this were a stove. And let's say in my enthusiasm to talk to you, I put my hand on the stove and it was hot and I burnt my hand. Now most of you, even though I don't know you, would probably be very nice. Some of you have had medical training, some of you have had emergency treatment, some of you have first aid courses. Some of them brush over with some kind of ointment or some kind of bandage. You'd be very solicitous. Let me take a look at that. Here, maybe you should have a look at a hospital, you poor guy, and all this other stuff. Why? Because you're nice people. But what if we were to meet tomorrow night? same gym? And what if I went over to the same stove and put the same hand on it and burned it again? Your image of me would change a little bit, wouldn't it? You'd start to think, let's say we met the night after that, and I burned my hand again. And let's say I said to you, why is this always happening to me? You'd be convinced of what you were suspecting in the first place. He really is an idiot. Why is this always happening to you? You'd say, what do you mean happening? You act as though this is something that jumped out of the wall and happened to you. Do you have no concept of your own contribution to this? Because there are always two reasons for what happens to us. There are always two sets of factors. This is easy for adults to see, but not so easy for young people to see. So when we speak to our kids about what we're waiting for, what we're watching for, what we're hoping to see, this is one of them. There are the factors over which we have no control. I didn't leave the stove on. It's not my fault. I can't be blamed for that. But I put my hand on the stove. That is my fault. That's my doing. The question is, and it's a very crucial question, why do I really believe that my hand is burned? Why do I believe I'm in pain now? The child will always say it's because some jerk left the stove on. The adult will always say, this jerk put his hand on it. It's an acid test for responsibilities. That's what we're looking for. Because if we ascribe the responsibility for my pain, the factors over which I have no control, I must wait for those factors to change so that I can be comfortable. I could be waiting a long time. The word for that is dependency. And we want our kids to be independent, don't we? We want them to stand on their own two feet. We want them to run their own lives. We want them to make their own decisions. We don't want them depending on us all the time for anything, including money, time, wisdom. We want them to be self-sufficient, independent. That's what we want. That's what they want too. They say, don't tell me what to do. Let me make my own decisions. I want to be in charge of my life. And we say, good, fine, that's what we want. We both want the same thing, so what's the problem? The problem is, if you ask parents, what is it that bugs you about young people? Oh, well, you can't tell them what to do. They have to make all their decisions. Didn't you just say you wanted that? Yes, I want them to be independent, but not yet. It's all a case of timing, isn't it? Sure, my son should drive a car. A young man should drive a car. That's important to me. He's 46 years old. He should drive a car. 16, scares the willies out of me. I want my daughter to have a wonderful sex life. A wonderful, vibrant, active sex life. After I'm dead. Because I don't want to be around. She's having this wonderful sex life, but I do want it. But not yet. That's the whole thing. They think they're ready. We think they're not. So let's talk tonight about the things to watch for that show us that they're ready. Because they're going to say, this isn't a child, you know. Why are you treating me like one? And we say, because it's not how you look. It's how you act. And if you take responsibility for the situation you're in, that's what an adult does. And if you blame factors over which you have no control, that's what a child does. And by the way, it doesn't matter how old that child is. So it's not the school, it's not the teacher, it's not the principal, it's not the neighborhood, it's not the city. All those things are involved, yes. But what are you bringing to your problem that you're having? This isn't happening to you. Life doesn't happen to you. What are you bringing to it? Because that's the only thing you can change. The moment you take responsibility for your own contribution to the situation you're in, that's your declaration of independence, something that's very important to this particular city. That's when you need never worry about burning your hand again, no matter how many stoves are left on. But if you're the parent saying, I'm treating you like a child because you're acting like a child, start acting grown up, then it's incumbent upon yourself to do the same. Yeah, you feel stupid like I would, burning my hand 3 times. And yes, that was kind of a stupid thing to do, but at least I can learn. And that's when I take control. That's when the locus of control comes to me. Neurologically speaking, most of the beliefs that we hold below our level of consciousness. In other words, most of the things we believe, we don't even know we believe them. Yet, they determine our behavior. And most of those beliefs, that we don't even know what they are wrong. And when we act on wrong beliefs, we get into trouble. But it's what we believe. Some examples of getting it wrong. A man says, I have no reason to live. I can't offer anything to anyone. No one appreciates me. I'm just a pain in everyone else's life. Everyone would be better off if I weren't here. We look at that man and say, how could you possibly come away with that conclusion? I'm looking at the same fellow and I see a vibrant, active, caring, accomplished man who's a good father and a good husband and a good member of our community. I'm looking at the same thing. How can two people look at the same thing and see it so differently? And I am going to tell you that I think you're wrong, but you'll tell me that I'm wrong. And it's your belief upon which you'll act. What do we do about a wrong belief like that? What do we do about a woman who insists on sitting naked in a field of snow, waiting for God to come in a chariot and take her to heaven? And that's what she tells the police, and the police say, listen, lady, you're creating a disturbance and we have to take you away. Would she go? No, she wouldn't go. Because she has her orders, and she believes it. And she will stay in that field, and so would I, and so would you. Because that's what mental illness is. It's an illness of the brain that forces them by an imbalance, and a very unfortunate imbalance in their chemistry, to look at things over here, but see things over there. And that's what they believe is true. How do we change their mind? By changing the source of their mind, their brain. And changing your mind is so endemic to a school, isn't it? Because I can't think, and I've said this many times to your students and to the staff here, I can't think of a better definition for the one word learning than changing your mind. Oh, I used to believe this. Now I have more information. Now I've learned something. I've changed my mind. That's what learning is. If you're in a school and you're not interested in changing your mind, I don't know what you're doing in that school. It's all about learning. It's about realizing what I used to believe, and now I believe something different, and I'll continue to look for evidence that will change my mind continually through life, so I'll be what really is, and not just some jargony phrase, a lifelong learner. The brain's job is to let us know as exactly as possible what's going on out there, so that we have a chance of making a good choice about what to do about what's going on out there. The more our experience of what's going on in the world conforms to what really is going on in the world, the safer we are. That's the brain's job. A drug is defined as a chemical that alters the physiology of the target organ, that alters the job of the brain, that perforce causes an individual to experience things different from reality, which takes us away from the direction of safety and places us in jeopardy. The more we're taken away from experience things as they are, the more jeopardous our life. But ironically, and no one knows why, but in the human brain, experiencing things different from reality is also inherently amusing. We love experiencing things different from reality. Hollywood wouldn't exist if we didn't. Why would we go to an amusement park and find it just hilarious to look at ourselves in a mirror when it's curvy that makes us look like we weigh 800 pounds? Is that funny? Evidently it is. I shaved this morning in a mirror that was flat. It wasn't that funny. I didn't laugh hardly at all. But in a curvy mirror, I probably would have had a lot of chuckles. Why? Because experiencing things different from reality is inherently fun. Look at all the illusions we love to look at. But dangerous at the same time. Drugs create an illusion by making us experience things different from reality? Is it fun?
Sure it is. Of course it is.
Is it dangerous?
Sure it is.
You betcha. It's very dangerous. But who in this room could blame anyone who wakes up each morning to a reality of pain, of suffering? Maybe it's physical pain, maybe it's emotional pain, maybe it's poverty, maybe it's doubt, maybe it's shame, maybe it's regret, maybe it's war, maybe it's hunger, maybe it's terror. Who among us could blame anyone for wanting, even temporarily, to experience the world in a way that's different from that reality, and choosing drugs as a way of escaping a very distasteful reality? I'm asking for a little bit of empathy. Someone said that we'd feel good if our kids were sympathetic or empathetic, could understand how other people feel and why they do things. That's what we ought to do, in my opinion. That's what we ought to teach our kids to do. Understand. Not to accept. Not to excuse, but to explain. To get closer to the truth. Another way that people experience things different from reality, experience things wrong, if you want to say that, where their belief is wrong, has nothing to do with racism, has nothing to do with drugs, has nothing to do with mental illness. It simply has to do with immaturity. Jean Piaget, I mentioned this to the staff today, did an experiment many years ago. I don't know how many of you know Jean, probably personally.
No, probably not personally.
He died today in 1980. But he was a very brilliant developmental neuroscientist, neurobiologist from France. And from Switzerland, right? He was French Swiss, that's right. Thank you for correcting me on that. I don't know why I said that. He wrote in French, but never mind. One experiment that everyone loves is based on what's called the law of conservation of volume. So you can try this if you want. Get a kid who's 3, get a kid who's 8, get a kid who's 14, and get a kid who's 18. You can rent these if you don't have any of your own. Just find someone somewhere, grab some, get off the street. I think that's illegal, but you can try it. It's for a good cause, kid. Take a pitcher of water, let's say, a measuring cup, 2 glasses the same size, the same shape, a tall, thin cylinder, and a short bowl. That's the apparatus you need. Pour a certain amount of water into the measuring cup and have everyone look at it, and let's say it's 300 milliliters of water, and pour that into a glass. Pour another 300 milliliters of water, exactly the same amount, pour it into the other glass. The glasses are the same size and shape, and say, which one has more? Everyone will say it's the same, even the 3-year-old. Now pour the one glass into the tall cylinder and the other into the short bowl, and the 3-year-old changes her mind. He says, now this one has more. You're so stupid, say the other kids. How can you possibly believe there's more there? The kid says, what do you mean, how can I possibly believe? Just take a look, it's so obvious, there's more there now. Is that a stupid 3-year-old or just a 3-year-old? We wouldn't call that kid stupid. What's going on? How much water refers to the volume of water? Volume is a 3-dimensional concept. Length times width times height. What does it tell us about that brain? 2 dimensions. You can't convey the awareness of a dimension to someone whose brain can't grasp it. They know, they can say the word 3D, but they have no idea what the 3rd dimension means. They have no idea how it feels to live in a world with depth. Then you say to the 8-year-old, I'm a little worried, you know, about your friend David. David, what's wrong with David? Nothing's wrong with David. David's a great guy. But you're always at David's house. David's always here. It's you and David, David and you. I'm worried that you're putting all your eggs in one basket. The 8-year-old says, hold on, are we talking about David or eggs? So we're talking about David and eggs. So David, I get, but where did the eggs come from? Well, eggs come from chickens. Well, that's right, so what are we really talking about? Then before you know it, you're completely off topic. And you yourself are confused. Say, all right, I'm sorry I mentioned the eggs. Forget about the eggs. Well, you brought it up. I know, I'm sorry I did. Because putting all your eggs in one basket is an abstract concept. And your kids can't understand abstract concepts. They're concrete people. Egg can only be one thing. That yellow thing that you crack into a pan and half with your breakfast. That's an egg. This David stuff, I don't know what you mean. But what I mean is, let's say David's family moves away. You only have one friend. That's like dropping a basket of eggs. Don't even bother. Don't even. I'm worried about the possibility that David might move and then you won't have any friends. That's better. Why, you say to a seven-year-old, why do you do this painting this way? What is it anyway? Well, can't you see it's a bird and a tree? You say, oh, no, you see. Okay, well, why did you put the bird there? Because. Yeah, I know, because, but why? He said, well, I told you why. The answer is because. He says, yeah, but why because? You say, listen, read my lips. The answer to your question is because. And we don't want to accept that, but that's a very good answer to a concrete person. Which gives us a hint as to what to do when they want to know how come they have to go to bed. Because! Finally, someone's talking my language. You see them walking upstairs, scratching their chin. Because I like that. I can accept myself sometimes. That's a terrific answer, they say. But we don't do that at all, no. Because we think our kids are geniuses. Because if you don't go to bed now, you'll be tired in the morning. The morning, that's the future. That has to do with time. Time's the fourth dimension. They just got the third dimension, for crying out loud. They have no idea what the morning is. Zero idea. You know what it sounds like? Because if you don't go to bed now, no idea what you're talking about. The reason you have to go to bed now is because. Good answer. Then it happens. Then it happens. Puberty. You see how visceral it becomes? I didn't mean to make you sick, I'm sorry. What's going on there? All kinds of things. All changes. Everything becomes different. And do we tell our kids this is going to happen? You bet. Sure we do. Why wouldn't we? It's only fair. Any kind of change could be very frightening if no one knew what was happening. A girl of 11 wakes up one morning and she's got a pain like no pain she's ever had before. And she doesn't seem to get rid of it. It stays there the whole day. Going to the bathroom doesn't help. You know it wouldn't. Stretching out, doing her downward dog, that's not going to help. It just doesn't. It's not that kind of a pain. It's a different kind of a pain. And then she starts to bleed. Are we going to let her go through that without telling her that it's going to happen? Are we going to allow her to experience that without telling her that, perverse as it seems, here's a case where pain and bleeding mean that you're healthy? Why wouldn't we do that? We ought to tell her, we should tell her, and we do tell her. Because even though you can't take the pain away from the situation, you can take the fear, so we do. And all the other changes that could be so scary if we didn't at least know they were normal. Tell your kids about all the changes. Make sure you know about them. Tell them about them. Tell them about all the ones that you know about, like boobs and things like that. Tell them the ones you're not so clear on, like the pubic fat pad in boys. You know about that one, right? Right? Boys develop a pad of fat over their pubic bone. They do this normally and naturally. Why would we tell them that? It's easy enough to tell them, but we don't. But that's not the real problem. The real problem is that we don't tell them about the most important change of all, vastly more important than any other. You're going to lose your child's mind. Your brain is part of your body, and your mind is your brain. There's no mind separate from your brain. If it's mental, it's brain. If it's psychological, it's brain. It's just a different language. Why wouldn't you tell them that you're going to lose your child's mind? But you'll get a better one. You'll get an adult brain. But it takes a while. There's a learning curve. It won't seem like anything makes sense for a while. And it'll take time to learn how to use this new machine. But it's better. It's more powerful. There's more stuff on it. There's more games on it, even. And you know what happens when there's games on a new computer? We want to try them. Here's a game that wasn't on the old computer. Sex. That wasn't on the old computer. It's on the new one. And they want to try it out. So a lot of time otherwise doing homework is done playing this new game. I don't mean they're going and doing it. What I mean is they're thinking about it. They're obsessed with it. They want to know more. Well, did she? Would she? Is she? How is? What happened? Are we going? I don't know. I think I will. So much time wasted on this new game. Not really wasted. Important. The homework isn't getting done. It's 4 in the morning. Are you going to stop and start doing your homework yet? Of course I will. It's still early. I'll go back to. Kids will tell you, you know, teenagers need a lot more sleep than adults. Everybody knows that. It's in the science. They do. They need 1.5 hours more sleep than adults. Not 5.5 hours more sleep. They don't have to sleep till noon. If they go to bed at 10, they can still get up at 7 and get to school on time and have all the sleep that teenagers need. But let's get back to this mind change. What does it mean? What does it imply? If it's like analogous to taking the insides out of their computer and putting in new insides, but the old computer looks the same. They don't know what's new, so they try doing things that they used to do. They have to get their English signed out, or maybe it's a math quiz, or maybe it's an essay. They were writing, it's in there, we tell them, but they can't find it because everything has changed. Trying to use this new machine gets them frustrated, especially as time goes by and they're running out of time. So they get angry and they start feeling crazy and they start feeling stupid and they start feeling confused. And why is this happening to me? And they say, and what is going on? Why wouldn't we tell them? Your computer has been changed. It's a better computer, that's what's going on. Why wouldn't we tell them that? That's what our kids see. That concrete, safe world where there was only one answer. Where there's only one thing an egg could be. Now there's so many answers and they all could be right. And they need to know. Because the more they know, the safer they are. And adolescence engenders a situation in which they know less and less and less of everything. Which generates, of course, the behavior that we see so often in teenagers. A demand for a good answer. Why do I have to go to bed now? Because you do. Sorry, Mom. Sorry, Dad. I'm not a child anymore. That was okay when I was 7. Now I need to know. And I need to know a lot of things. Why did you tell me this? Why did you expect me to believe that? Why did I have to accept that? I'm going to challenge everything I've been taught because I know that there are different possible good answers and right answers. And I need to know, because I need to know what to do and where to go and what to say and who am I. And I don't know any of that stuff, and I'm entirely insecure now. So I'm going to ask these questions, and if I don't get a good answer, I'm going to ask them louder. And if I still don't get a good answer, there's going to be a little attitude in my voice when I ask it next time, and sooner or later, I'm going to stop asking you altogether. I'm not even going to come to you, because I'm not getting a good answer from you. Even if that answer is, I don't know, I wish I did. And they'll go to somewhere else for their answers. Someone on the internet or their friends who won't have any better answers. Possibly any better answers than you could give them. Give them a good answer. Give them your best answer, even if it's, I don't know. In Canada, we had an interesting situation. Two, actually, and I'll tell you about both of them. The Prime Minister at the time got up in front of the Parliament and said, I'm proposing that we have free trade with the United States of America. The guy on the other side of the house got up and said what a terrible idea it was. Because you're not thinking about this, you haven't considered that, and you've left out this whole part of it. And then he sat down. And 3 months later, he was the Prime Minister. Because the government was voted out of office. The first thing this man did was to get up in Parliament and propose free trade with the United States of America. And everybody said that he was a hypocrite because he had changed his mind. And I said, no, he didn't change his mind, he changed his job. Because when he got up in Parliament and opposed, he did so as the leader of the opposition, whose job it is to oppose, whose job it is to give a voice to everybody in the land who would contradict the government, who would feel that they'd been heard, who would feel that they'd been considered and respected. Even though they didn't get their way, at least they had a chance to debate. Why don't we do that in our homes? Why don't we give our kids a chance? chance to oppose. Why do we insist on steamrolling them? Which makes them feel kind of stupid and unimportant. Which makes them stop going out to voting polls when they get the chance. Because they think no one cares what they think anyway.
Why don't we listen to them?
Why don't we hear what they have to say? Why don't we give them a chance to participate in the legislative process? Why don't we give them a chance to have a voice? That's called empowerment. That's called ownership. That's called participation. And the chance of obeying the law is so much greater when they were there when it was made and had something to say about it. Why wouldn't we do that? Why do we rob our kids of that sense of pride, of confidence, the willingness to speak up? I want my kid to speak up when he's not comfortable. I want my daughter when she's at a party and someone's abusing someone verbally, I want her to speak up. I want my son when he's at a party and someone pulls out a beer or a joint or pulls out something else, and they do, you know. I want him to speak up and say, I'm not happy with that, I don't like that, I'm leaving, I'm not participating in that. That's what I want my kid to do. I want him to be a leader and not a follower. I want him to say, this is wrong. I want him to feel comfortable saying that, and I want him to have a lot of experience saying, I oppose. Instead, kids often go along with what they see going on around them. They go along. Good kids will stand by and watch someone being bullied. Whether it's in the schoolyard, on the street, or on the tube, in the internet. Why? Why won't they stand up and say, I oppose. I'm against that. I won't participate. I won't go along with that. Why wouldn't we encourage them to do that, to have that power, that sense of power? Why wouldn't we do that? And why wouldn't we explain bullying to them in a way that's so easy to understand? Anyone here know what a piranha is? It's a fish, right? It lives in the Amazon. It's about that big. It's yellowy green. It's got a big mouth with big teeth. And it's a flesh eater. Now, a piranha's not a bad guy or girl. They don't feel like they're being vicious when they tear your leg apart. They're just having a meal. I had a meal tonight. To be honest, I tore some animal's meat apart. It was a very nice sandwich. Very large. But when it's an adolescent, it's about the same size and almost exactly the same shape and color as a piranha. But it has a very small mouth and almost no teeth, and it eats plankton. But if I saw one of those guys swimming around, I'm not going to stick my foot in the water and take it down. That's probably a package. No, I think it's probably a piranha. So I stay away. It's called protective coloration. We've all heard of that, of course. It's how the weak defend themselves against predators. The bully puts on a tough coat, speaks tough, acts rough, acts mean, saying, keep away from me or I'll hurt you. Protective coloration. What he's really saying is, stay away from me or you'll hurt me. The tougher I am, the more I make you want to be away from me, the safer I am. And the reason I'm that way is because I was hurt very badly. I don't want to be hurt anymore. And I don't care if no one likes me. Well, I do. And I would rather they like me. But if it means being safe, I'll do what I have to. And I've never heard any expert on bullying contradict that view of bullying. So what should we do? Invite the bully and offer him or her something that they're really looking for. Some responsibility, some respect, some dignity. We can do that. We don't have to excuse the behavior, but couldn't we offer them some participation? Make the bully the head of the anti-bullying task force at school. What could they possibly do then? We all have beliefs that we didn't know we had, and we're wrong, right? You remember that? That's maybe why you're hesitating. But three people weren't afraid of that. Three people, three intelligent people, three experienced people who've seen many sunsets and see many more, I hope, said three. Now there's many answers coming from intelligent, experienced people to a very simple question, a question that frankly has very little importance. Who really cares how big the sun is? Nothing much turns on that. But if I were to leave the room and come back in a few minutes, I found this woman strangling that man and that man hitting that woman with his briefcase and everybody calling each other names and arguing and being disrespectful to everybody and physically abusive, I'd say, what's going on? Well, she's an idiot. How can it be an orange if it's a golf ball? A golf ball, you're both nuts. It's a ping pong ball. It's a golf ball. It's a big balloon. These aren't stupid people. Makes it so tough. These are smart people. But that not everybody looking at the same thing is going to see it the same way. And to recognize that instead of murdering other people whose opinion differs from mine, and let's say instead of asking how big the sun was, I asked you what God wants for us in this world. And I went and everybody was arguing and strangling each other and murdering everybody. That becomes different, doesn't it? Because if you're murdering people over an empirical issue of how big the setting sun is, that's just plain silly. Because it's an empirical question. Take your balloon, take your orange, take your golf ball, wait for the sun to set, and you'll see. You don't have to argue with that. And by the way, if you were to hold a single strength headache tablet less than half the diameter of an American dime, that's how big the sun is. Hear that? I was listening. That's not fair. You weren't listening, but I heard it. Just as soon as I said that, there was silence. And about 2 seconds after the silence, I heard it. What a powerful sound. Probably one of the most powerful sounds we can have, because that was the sound of a human being learning, changing their mind, realizing that all this time I've had a belief that I didn't even know what it was, then I found out what it was, only to find out I've been wrong. What else can I do but change my mind? Finally, empathy. And a recognition that there is a future, and in that future there are consequences to behavior now. And I did this with the senior students this afternoon. I'll do it very quickly with you. I said to them, what's a three-year-old like? So they answered me. They said, all kinds of things. Let me ask you, what's a three-year-old like? You know, three-year-olds, those little kids, they're short people. You know, they wear short pants and they have high voices. You know what I'm talking about, right? What are they like?
Busy.
Busy.
Cute.
Crazy.
Testing the boundaries.
Testing the boundaries.
Curious.
Yes, all those things. Okay, so think about it. Remember what you said. Why are they that way? And I said to the kids, and I got a good laugh from this. I said, I know you know why they're this way. Because they're 3 years old, and they've just experienced the physiological transition from segmental control of the spine to supra-segmental control of the spine. And they said, that's it, I was just going to say that. I was just going to say that same thing. It's coming off. Anyway, but that is what it is. What does it mean? It means that at the spinal level, before the brain takes over, everything is reflexive. If the bladder fills up with urine, it sends a message to the spinal cord. The spinal cord says, I'm just a spinal cord. I can't do anything about it. The only thing I can do is void. If it's full, empty. That's it. Brain says, I see this happening. I'm not in control. You're on your own. There's that nice Persian rug. It seems like a shame, but what are you going to do? Well, what are you going to do? You're going to give your kid a diaper. Right? And everybody knows who wears diapers, besides American astronauts. Babies. Babies wear diapers. That's who. So when the brain says, okay, I'm in control, supra-segmental control, don't just let go. Walk upstairs, sit on that pot over there, now let go, and everybody applauds, and that's terrific, because no longer is there a diaper. And the kid says, see any babies? See any babies in this area of my body here? See this area? See, because babies have diapers. I had one kid stopping in a supermarket in Chicago once. I told the kids this. Or maybe it was a sack, I don't remember. I'm feeling this tug on my pant leg. I'm in the checkout line. There's this tug from, like, down around the knee level. I look down and say, kid, I don't know. And he's just looking up at me. He says, I'm not a baby. I said, did I ask? So I need to know. I'm not a baby. My brother's a baby. He wears a diaper. I said, that's right.
2-year-old. And let's say the phone rang and you had to leave the room. You came back and the door was open and the kid is toggling down toward the traffic.
What would you feel at the time the kid said, panicked, scared, angry, guilty, oh my God, what's going to happen?
Afraid, responsible. What did you do?
I ran and grabbed him. Why?
He was going to get hurt.
What a powerful statement. You were going to get hurt. A prediction of the future. A statement of understanding that there is a future, and in that future, there's a consequence to what you're doing now. That's what we're looking for in our kids. That understanding. And tell me, if the kid says, how did you know? How do you know? What makes you so sure it's going to get hurt? Your sons and daughters or teenager will say, I know because I'm older than you. Not I'm better, not I'm smarter, I'm older than you. Which is really what they're saying is, my brain is more developed than yours. And I can see a danger in a behavior that you can't see. And if you can't see it, it's my job to protect you from the consequences of that dangerous behavior. What I told your kids today is, as grown up as you look, as adult as you may look, in all of that traditional physical way, there's a change that's still going on in your body. And that part of your body is your brain. And it's going to be another 7 or 8 years before that change completes, because that's how much more complicated the brain is than all the other tissues of the body. And because of that, when you do things like disrespect or abusive language, when you experiment with drugs, when you experiment sexually before you're emotionally prepared, when you cut corners, when you cheat, that's how I feel. I feel scared, angry, panicked, and guilty and responsible watching that happen. And I will run after you, and I will stop you, and I will bring you back, and you'll hate it, and you'll tell me you were having fun, and then there was nothing wrong, and I will say, no, that's not true. You were going to get hurt. And I know that because I'm older than you. And don't tell me you don't know what I'm talking about, because you just said you would do the same thing. And then they get it. Then they realize. Then they understand. And it's that understanding that we're looking for. And I went straight into a story of this man who had a daughter with his wife, of course, and the daughter was 4 years old when the mother tragically died. And the father had to raise his daughter on his own. And he did so because he loved his daughter and he did a good job, as good as he could. But when she became about 11 or 12, the changes started happening. He thought, she needs a mother. I can't do this on my own. He remarried. He married a woman he didn't love that much, but she was okay, and after all, she had daughters of her own who were kind of the same age as his daughter, and he felt, she'll mother my daughter, she'll help her, and her daughters will help my daughter. But as the daughter got to be about 17, it didn't happen that way. The woman didn't treat his daughter so well. He treated her kind of badly. And her daughters didn't treat his daughter so well either. And she became despondent. And she became sad and depressed. And she could only resort to praying. And her prayers were answered. And then I asked your kids, who answered the prayer? And right now there was silence. And I said, come on, you've heard this story 1,000 times. Who answered her prayer? And someone said, I know, the fairy godmother. And said, don't worry, I'm going to give you a chemical that will change who you are and who you feel. It will change your appearance. It will give you confidence. And you can go to the party and you can be successful with that guy, but I'm warning you, the chemical's going to wear off and you're going to have a choice in it. You can look around for more chemical, but there won't be any. You can let him just see who you really are, or you can leave. And at that moment, the young people in the room change forever. Finally realized that's how adults hear the story of Cinderella. And they will never hear it as a child again. Sorry. That's what growing up is. It's realizing that there are meanings beyond the superficial meaning. Thank you so much for having me here. It's been a wonderful day. It's been a long day and a tiring one. I'm happy to stay around a little longer and answer some questions. Please don't applaud. I don't need that. Does anyone have any questions? If you have questions and would like to stay, I'm happy to stay.
Afterwards, I'll sell my book and I'll sign it for you. But if you must leave, I understand. Please go ahead and do so. I won't be offended. Thank you all very, very much. And good night.